last video presentation is by me, and I think it will be a very nice and a palatable presentation, because and very important also because all of us is not so interested in the suprarenal gland. Few of us, most of you, of course, are paying attention to the suprarenal gland. We should pay attention to the suprarenal gland, and I hope that very short video presentation will spotlight the importance of examining the suprarenal mass during any EUS examination. The adrenal gland is the site of several pathological conditions. It may be non-neoplastic, like hyperplasia or hemorrhage. It may be neoplastic, whether malignant or benign masses. A minority are hyperfunctioning. About 10% of all suprarenal masses. And this may lead to endocrine disorders like of all suprarenal masses. This characterized by normal hormonal level. Therefore, most cases of adrenal masses are discovered incidentally because it is non-secreting tumor, asymptomatic, and these tumors has a famous name, which is incidentalomas. So let us concentrate on the suprarenal neoplasms. Most of them are benign neoplasms. The commonest is cortical adenoma, the most important incidentaloma, and it may be myelolipoma, lipoma, hemangioma, lymphangioma, paraganglioma, or oncocytoma. The most frequent malignant neoplasm of the suprarenal glands are metastases. And the most common primary tumor sending metastases to the suprarenal are lung cancer, breast, colon, pancreatic, kidney, and hepatocellular carcinoma. Those colored by red can be seen nicely during endoscopic ultrasound examination. So sometimes our colleagues refer to us EUS cases to assess lung cancer, pancreatic cancer, renal carcinoma, especially in von Hippel-Lindau syndrome, and hepatocellular carcinoma. So in these cases, we should visualize clearly the suprarenal glands because this primary tumor can send metastases to the suprarenal gland. The adrenal glands are the fourth most frequent site of metastases in malignant disease. Of course, after liver metastases, lung metastases, and then bone metastases. However, in cancer, this is very important notice. In cancer patients, approximately 50% of adrenal tumors are benign. So when a case referred for us for studying or staging or doing FNA for pancreatic tumors or lung tumors or GI tumors, and we found a suprarenal mass, this is not necessarily a metastasis. It carries only a 50% liability of being metastasis and 50% incidentaloma, because incidentalomas are very common. And hence the importance of doing FNA of these suprarenal masses in the presence of primary tumor like pancreatic or lung, because if proved metastatic, this will change the line of management from resectable, for example, to palliative therapy. But if this mass proved to be benign, like cortical adenoma, then if the mass is resectable, we can go for radical surgery aiming at cure. So it is very important to realize the fact that not necessarily every left suprarenal mass in the presence of primary tumor in the pancreas, not necessarily to be malignant. It carries only 50% liability of being malignant and 50% of being benign incidentaloma, even in the presence of primary malignant tumor. Primary adrenal carcinoma is very rare, account for 0.02 to 0.2 of all cancer related deaths. So it is very rare. The commoner is suprarenal metastasis. What is the role of EOS in adrenal tumors? Detection of small adrenal tumors, of course, and characterization of the adrenal tumors and the assessing criteria of malignancy in adrenal tumors. We should suspect whether the mass is benign or malignant based on EOS features, but finally, we should do FNA in the presence of primary malignant tumor in the pancreas. But if we are doing EOS for another cause, no primary malignant tumor, and you find incidentaloma, we don't do FNA because most of them are incidentaloma. So it differs. If the primary tumor is there, I should do FNA because it carries a liability of 50% to be metastasis. But if there is no primary tumor, then, and the mass has benign criteria, as I will mention later, then leave it alone without FNA. We can use EOS can detect early recurrences of malignant adrenal tumors, detection of extra adrenal tumors, and of course, possibility of doing FNA at the time of examination. Let us see what is the normal appearance of left suprarenal glands. For many years, I'm working in the field of sonography since 30 years, and I can't see the suprarenal during sonography. Very rarely normal suprarenal can be detected by sonography, but I believe by then that it is around the structure. No, the normal suprarenal gland is not around the structure at all. It is a seagull appearance. Seagull is a bird, as I mentioned before, with a very small body here and two long wings. This is the normal appearance of the suprarenal glands. How to examine for the left suprarenal glands? I mentioned before, in the first day during the examination of pancreatic biliary system, in station 4, we locate the echo endoscope at the cardia and to search for our landmark, which is the abdominal aorta and the origin of the celiac, superior mesenteric, and the left renal artery. So this is the aorta and this is the uptake of the celiac, superior mesenteric, and left renal. I push the echo endoscope slightly forward till I find the splenic vein and splenic artery. Here, according to station 4, I do two moves. Clockwise rotation to visualize the pancreatic body, left kidney, left suprarenal, and the spleen, and then anticlockwise. So if we want to find the left suprarenal, we will do clockwise rotation at the level of the splenic artery, splenic vein, and the pancreatic body. So at that level, this is the splenic vein, splenic artery, and this is the pancreatic body. Clockwise rotation. I can find the left kidney and the very small angiomyolipoma of the left kidney. And I can withdraw the echo endoscope up to go to the upper pole of the left kidney, to withdraw the echo endoscope and slight upward deflection by the big wheel. And here very nicely seen the bird or the seagull appearance of the body of the seagull and the wings of the seagull, wing to the right side and wing to the left side. This is the normal shape of the left suprarenal gland. Can we examine the right? Very difficult, really. Very, very difficult to find the right suprarenal gland, but we can search for it. If there is a large mass, we can see the large mass of the right suprarenal, but very hard to see the normal right suprarenal. We locate the echo endoscope in the second part of the duodenum and are doing clockwise rotation till we see the segment 6 of the liver and the right kidney here, expecting to have to find the right suprarenal mass, but it is really very difficult to visualize the normal right suprarenal gland. Let us see some of the suprarenal masses and how to differentiate between malignant suprarenal masses and benign suprarenal masses. This is an example of a very benign left suprarenal mass. Yes, it is. This mass is, first, it is very well defined. Second, it is homogeneous, no areas of breakdown. Third, it is not too large, but it is not a prerequisite, but it is rather small or moderate sized. And fourth, which is very important, that it respects the shape of the suprarenal gland. It respects the wing. This is the wing of the normal suprarenal gland. So this is the mass and this is the wing. If it is a malignant mass, it will destruct, mostly it will destruct the shape of the normal suprarenal gland. But here, this is a very nicely seen wing of that suprarenal gland. So mostly it is a benign tumor. Well-defined, no significant areas of breakdown, rather small, and respecting the shape of the suprarenal glands. And there is a fifth item, which is the elastography. If we have the option of elastography, it will be hard on elastography if it is malignant and soft if it is benign. So this is an incidentaloma, cortical adenoma. This is an example of a benign suprarenal mass, two benign masses in the same patient. This is a cortical adenoma, very well defined, very regular border, no areas of breakdown, not so large. And here, respecting the wing, the normal shape wing of the suprarenal. You see this wing, if it is a malignant mass, it will destruct the whole gland. And here there is a very small hyperechoic structure like lipoma or like hemangioma. This is a small myelolipoma of one of the wings of the suprarenal gland. So this patient has a cortical adenoma and a small myelolipoma. If there is no primary tumor, no primary pancreatic malignancy or lung malignancy or HCC, so leave it alone. It is an incidentaloma. Don't waste your time and cost in doing FNA in such patient. Okay, very nice. Let us see this patient with a very large mass, irregular, large, heterogeneous. There are areas of breakdown. Okay, and this here, the kidney, and this is a IVC and aorta. So this is a large, ill-defined, irregular border, areas of breakdown, and nearly destructing the shape of the suprarenal glands. The wings of the suprarenal glands are no further identified. It is distorted and destructed by the invading mass. And this is the four main differences between the benign and malignant suprarenal gland. Yes, the fifth difference is the elastography and strain ratio. This is a large mass, large left suprarenal mass. Yes, areas of breakdown, it is heterogeneous mass, areas of breakdown, rather large. When we do elastography, it is mainly a blue, so it is a hard mass. So it is a large mass, number one, ill-defined border, number two, heterogeneous aspect with areas of breakdown, number three, destructing the shape of the seagull appearance of the left suprarenal mass, and have a high elastography score and high strain ratio. denoting its hard consistencies. So this carries the whole criteria of malignancy. This mass is detected in the presence of primary pancreatic duct adenocarcinoma, although it is most likely a malignant mass, but USFNA here should be done, because if it is proved 100% malignant, this will change the line of management of this patient from maybe resectable pancreatic mass to palliative inoperable mass, and it will be sent for chemotherapy. Here, as I told you, we can do it simply FNA, very simple, because the left suprarenal mass is very near to the echo on the scope, very easy to do a suprarenal FNA, and FNA is enough. FNB, it may be better, but I think both FNA and FNB are equal, because the cells are very characteristic of suprarenal malignancy. And as I told you, it's very easy to do it, because it is very, very, very near to the lumen, very, very near to the endoscope in the lumen of the gastric fundus. So we can do it very simply. And I have a nice series of left suprarenal gland FNA with high sensitivity and specificity. Okay, so the FNA can be done easily. It is like any FNA. Yes, this is here the needle, and you can do it very simply. No intervening structures, no intervening vessels, and very near to the lumen and very near to the echo endoscope. A meta-analysis of EUSFNA for adrenal lesions in 2019 found that the sensitivity of EUSFNA in detecting metastasis to the adrenals was 95% and specificity was 99%. This article, or this meta-analysis, strongly recommends performing EUSFNA in patients with known or suspected lung cancer and imaging evidence of an adrenal lesion, since only half of these patients have adrenal metastasis. So the take-home message, always search for suprarenal metastasis, although rare, but if found, it will change the line of management. And this, of course, in presence of primary tumors like pancreatic, lung, liver, or renal primary tumors. Only 50% of suprarenal masses detected in cases of pancreatic, lung, or GI malignancy are malignant metastatic masses. So EUSFNA will be recommended in this situation. Suprarenal incidentalomas are common. So in absence of primary malignant lesion, no need for FNA, except if they have the criteria of malignancy, as previously mentioned, which are very large tumor, irregular outline, heterogeneous in texture, distracting the contour of the normal shape of the suprarenal glands, and has high elasticity score denoting its firm or hard consistency. And thanks for your